Judges 15, 14 through 15. And when he, Samson, came unto Lehi, the Philistines shouted. That shout was a shout of triumph against him. And the Lord didn't like that. So in the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon Samson, and the cords that were upon his arms became as flax that was burnt with fire, and his bands loosed from off his hands. He did not break them. The Holy Spirit loosed them because he knew his next. How do we know he knew his next? Verse 15, and he found. You don't find unless you look. You don't look unless you know that God is faithful. And he found a new jawbone of an ass, a new one. In other words, he hadn't been laying there for 1,000 years, and it was just nice and just bones and you know, that's it. It had all kinds of tissues and ook and guts. And the message is, don't miss your miracle because it's messy. He found it, and what did he do? And he put forth his hand. God, will you? Yeah, I gave you a jawbone. Go put your hand right there and grab it. You put your hand. He put his hand to it, and he took it. And when that happened, he slew 1,000 men therewith. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the revelations that you give us in this house. Anybody can get into the word, but only you, Holy Spirit, can pull something out of it because you are the author. And thank you, Lord, for being the author and finisher of our faith. We give you glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, look at your neighbor and say, amen. And look at your neighbor, other neighbor, and say, can he do it? And well, let's sit here. Let's see if we can make it through here. We all get excited about the new. But what if the new is in the same place as the old? And we're going to talk about that jawbone again. Look at your neighbor and say, jawbone again? It's going to be good. You can have a new job at the same old place with a new mindset. You can have a new marriage with the same person with a new mindset. Now, the jawbone was new, but it had to be found. It was in the same old place. It was a day before. I'm pausing for effect on purpose. I want you to get it. It was in the same place the day before. But now the old thing had a new purpose when given a new perspective. You just walk by it. But when you're seeking, you'll find. And even though that same old thing was there the day before, with a new perspective, it now has a new purpose. The jawbone was there the day before. Listen, with very little relevance to anything going on at all in this world. Outside of maybe a few vultures getting excited, that was it. I wonder how many things are just laying in our life. The same old thing could have a new purpose if we had a new perspective. That even though it's been there all of our life, you've heard me say this story, I'm just going to say it again. It's like, well, I don't have any skills, gifts, or talents, Pastor. I'm just, you know, just a bubbly, friendly person. We'll have a CEO of a major corporation find you and your attitude out, and you get paid the big bucks because you don't have a second chance for a first impression. So when you call Coca-Cola and you're the voice, hello, Coca-Cola, how can I help you? Can I direct your call? They want you to represent, yeah, that's us, and we want that to be represented. But for the person that's just, I've always just been that way, but, you know, I can't sing, I can't dance. I can't preach, can't teach. Can't build a car, don't know how to make a quilt. What kind of skills have I got in life? Baby, it's been there the whole time. And the old thing can have a new purpose. As soon as you let the Lord show you a new perspective. The jawbone had no purpose as of yesterday. But today, look at your neighbor and say, today. Today it became vital in Samson's destiny. And God's given assignment for next. Same old thing was just laying there day after day with no relevance to anything in the world, but was used mightily when the old thing had a new purpose because of a new perspective. Look at your neighbor and say, that's good. In other words, you don't march into tomorrow with a game plan solely based off of yesterday's results. Well, you've heard the thing about Thomas Edison. How many times did he fail before he finally got it right? Aren't you glad he finally got it right? Or what about the person that could, okay, let's just break it down. We in the deep south now. How about the person that invented air conditioning? Amen. Praise God they got it right, huh? Amen. Amen. But if your strategy is just based on yesterday, we've all got failures. Matter of fact, it says a righteous man falls 7 times, but he rises again. Why in the world would we need an intercessor? Come on now. Why would we need an advocate and an intercessor if we ain't going to stumble and fall from time to time? Why do we have John 1:9? If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us. Why is that in there? Because we're going to fall from time to time. But are you basing your tomorrow's promise on your yesterday's failure? You can't go and have a new strategy with an old mindset, because you got to be it even long before you get it. I think it was said recently, you know, when it comes to football, a coach said, everybody want to be the beast, but to be the beast, you got to do what beasts do. You want to be a victor. Everybody want to be a victor, but to be a victor, you got to do what victorious people do. Amen. Hallelujah. I am getting myself excited. We learn from yesterday. We can learn from yesterday, but we need to operate in today to remain effective. I mean, think about people that you know in your life is just moly grubbing. There's so many directions I could go in this. I'm trying to stay focused. Why is that? Because they still live in yesterday. See, depression comes when you can't see your tomorrow. Because you think your tomorrow is just going to be like today because yesterday was. And that's exactly why. You get to the heart of it, you start, get past all the mully grubbing, and you find out, they're going to open up about what they did to them. That's right, they did that to me. That happened to me. This wasn't right, that wasn't right. La, 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 la. Living in yesterday. Can learn from it. Don't live in it. You might need rest from it, but don't stay in it. Come on now. Because sometimes you can get new oil out of the same old jar. Throw 1 Kings 17:10-16 on the screen. Once again, this is Elijah. So he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman. Look at your neighbor and say, widow woman. And isn't it just amazing how crazy society has gotten? Can you just imagine CNN showing up? What a disgrace. prophet trying to take the last meal of an old widow woman. Do they know no boundaries? Bunch of preachers. Behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks, and he called to her. He said, my sheep know my voice. You better know his voice. He's not hiding nothing from you. He's hiding it for you. But are you going to seek in order to find? Now what? And he called to her and said, fetch me. Listen to this language now. I don't know you. What you rolling up in here talking down to me like that? That's this society, isn't it? Who you think you are? You don't know who you talking to. You don't know what level of crazy I'm about to unleash on you. Talking to me like that. Fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. You better know whose voice it is you're listening to. Don't miss this opportunity. Better humble yourself in the sight of God. And as she was going to fetch it, she was obedient. He called to her and said, bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thy hand. Oh, you want some more, huh? Okay. She knew it was the Lord speaking. And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake but a handful of meal and a barrel and a little oil and a cruse. And behold, I'm gathering two sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and my son that we may eat and die. Jesus. That almost sounds like that mullet grubber I said a minute ago, wasn't it? If I wash my car, it'll rain. If I'm pulling out, just as sure as the world, the last car is going to turn left. Hallelujah. And Elijah said unto her, fear not. Look at your neighbor and say, don't be afraid. Go and do as thou hast said. Go on with yourself. Do what I told you to do. But make me thereof. See, that's. Oh, man, so much teaching here. The divine, the law of first, the divine portion. Lord's always going to get first. Hallelujah. You can have all the trees in the garden, Adam, but those are mine. You can have the whole land of Israel, but that first battle, all that is mine. All through Scripture, you see it. The law of divine proportion, his. Amen. I know this is going to ruffle some theological feathers, but that's okay. Get fluffy for a second. Some people are the tithe. Moses, what? You don't want to go? You're going. What? This or that? Now you're going. Oh, you want this? If you okay, but you're going. Jonah, you going. Amen. But make thereof a little cake first and bring it unto me first. Seek what? First the what? And what else? And then what happens? You got to have the first. And then after, make for thee and for thy son. Look at your neighbor and say after. Look at your other neighbor and say you got it backwards. How many times do we do for us first and then we give God our leftovers? My. You really want to survive during a famine? Can you get what little you got to the Lord first? See, that just shows you your faith. You say, God don't need all that. No, he don't, but he's trying to get something to you, and what you're about to do is faith. You're saying you can take care of me better than I can take care of me, and that you're going to be faithful to do things that I can't do. So I've learned already in life, put the calculator up. What did he say? That's all you need to know. What did he say? For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And what happened? I didn't bunch of preachers. All they after is your money and your stuff. That's all they want. They just want what you got so they can have for themselves. Bunch of highfalutin. I get it. Listen, if you're a part of religion and tradition, I get it. Because it's not word-based. God operates by his word, not by man's tradition. So you can get your wallet out of your pocket, throw it down on the ground, and step on it three times and say, the Lord's my provider, and do it three more times and say, I trust in you. If you don't do this, if you are not operating in God's economic system, I don't care how many times you shout hallelujah over your wallet. That stepping on that ain't word-based. Might be fun for church, but you're going to be broke. Oh my, oh me. 15. I don't want a whole big everybody stepping on their feet and excited over some kind of little something. Here's what I want. I want y'all to be blessed. Yeah. I want you to walk in the blessing. Yeah. For you and your family. And you to show your children and your children's children the goodness of the Lord. Hallelujah. Verse 15, and she went and did according to the saying of Elijah. You crazy girl. You believe that stuff? You believe anything? Look at you. Talking about your whole family now. You ain't got no man around. You just got your kid. And you're going to give it to some slick-talked, silver-tongued preacher coming through town? I can't believe you did that. You crazy, girl. But she did. And he and her house did what? Ooh. See, we talked about this a little bit last week. God wants everybody to be blessed, but not everybody wants to come to God to be blessed. God loves everybody, but not everybody loves God. A man of faith trusts God, but a faithful man God will trust. And the barrel of meal wasted not, verse 16, neither did the cruse of oil fail according to the word of the Lord, which was spoken by Elijah. Once again, if you want to be a beast, you got to do what beasts do. If you want to survive the famine, well, you got to do what the survivors do. If you'll do what she did, you could have what she had. Do you not think for one second that the Lord would turn down somebody else that come to her house and said, blessed be the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and you're a man of God. I worship the Lord Almighty and was worshiping and bowed down before the Lord, that the Lord would what, just turn them away? But ain't it interesting how nobody wanted to come around? Think about that in that story. Everybody in the neighborhood getting real lean except for... Yeah. Look at Martha over there. Man, she put on a few pounds. Girl, your countenance looks good too. What's going on? Well, she heard the voice of the Lord. Same jar. New oil. You ready for new oil? But it's going to come out of the same jar. Yeah, the same old jar. That yesterday was just something that's just been, well, our family's been in our family forever. Every day I come in, I see it sitting right up there. It's a really pretty jar. With no real purpose or no real meaning. But remember, the old thing can have a new purpose with a new perspective. Same old jar. I'm meddling. Yes, I am. Same spouse, new marriage. Same job, new adventure. What we need for tomorrow is generally already in our lives if we would just look for it and look at it in a new perspective. Hallelujah. It all matters whose hands it's in. Whose hands is this in? Your life and the things of it. Whose hands is it in? Will you trust the Lord with all if he asks for it? Well, he did this time. She had it. He didn't ask for nothing she didn't have, but what she had, I want it all. And in the most inconvenient time, if she would have used common sense and operated in self-preservation, she would, listen, she would have only had one more meal. Not saying stuff just to blow smoke up here over the offering. What leaves your hand will never leave your life. If it's sown in faith, is the Lord not able? Some sow, some water, but the Lord gives the increase. And that's exactly what happened here. But because she had put all she had into the Lord's hands, it multiplied and sustained her in the famine, while many other wise people perished. Don't just go hand in hand what I was speaking last week. There's going to come a time. There's going to be come a time that door, that boat or that door is going to shut, Noah. There's going to be a time, five unwise versions, where she's going to, can we have some of yours? You're good Christian folk there, and the Lord says to give. Yeah, we got ours. You need to go to the store and get your own. It's like he said, in the last days, they'll be eating and drinking and carrying on just like nothing ever happened. Surely the Lord would not ask for everything from a poor old widow woman in a national famine. Hallelujah. Yes, he would. What do you already possess that you need for victory but lack the revelation to recognize? Have you took an inventory of what's really around you? Have you took an inventory of what's really inside the one you're with? There was a point in time many, 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 many years ago, the Lord let me see my wife through his eyes. Yes, I love to cuddle her and cradle her and pamper her, and she's my queen, and amen, all that stuff. Listen, she's tougher than I make out. It's just that I don't want her to have to be tough. Well, she could open the car door for herself, but I don't want her to. Why? Because I'm sending her a message. But she's also got gifts and skills. And when I get her counsel on some things that is in her wheelhouse, I stop and listen, because it's just not the one that maybe I disagreed with last night about, and we and kissed and made up and went to bed and woke up the next morning. That's not who I'm listening to right now. The anointing of God is speaking to me through her. I wonder how many marriages would be restored fully if we would just recognize the anointing that God has. Instead of seeing him with it, just
Or can't you find the laundry basket? How many years have we had the laundry basket in the same place, but yet I see the socks over here? If you can look past the socks, come on now. What do you already possess that you need for victory but lack the revelation to recognize it? The same old rock and rag, David, is plenty enough weaponry to take down your new giant. If you trust God, you will look and you will find. But what you see is determined by how you see. Can you see the treasure in the field, or all you see is a bunch of dirt and briars and thistles and thorns and brush? Well, just like I said earlier, what you honor, you can access. And if you dig enough, you can get to that treasure. She got treasure, husband. He got treasure, wife. But will you go treasure hunting instead of fault finding? If you trust God, you'll look and you'll find. It's there. It's just one new perspective, one revelation away from being revealed. Samson was unique. Let me pivot just a little bit here so we can get through this. Samson was unique among the judges because he was a one-man army against the Philistines. Other judges of Israel led armies against their enemies, but Samson fought alone. God will develop you privately before he displays you publicly. That's why so many people quit on God. It's because they think they're being buried, when in reality the Lord says, you're not being buried, you're being planted. Right. But unless you have a different perspective, one will look exactly like the other. Right. He develops you privately before he displays you publicly. So when your now what arrives, what if you're the only one on the field? I suspect that the 3,000 Israelites, and you can, for those taking notes, you can go back to Judges 15:11. That's where I got this number from. I just didn't pull it out of the sky because it sounded good. Judges 15:11. I suspect that the 3,000 Israelites who bound Samson were still present, or at least a portion of them were, that they were there when the battle started. Come on, listen to me now. Even Jesus, there's four kinds of soils. Wayside, stony, thorny. Only this one's going to produce results. Everybody was there when the battle started, but not everyone will be there with you through the battle. Especially if the carnage is exceptionally brutal and perpetual. Boom. Life is like, all right. Boom. Boom. Boom, boom, boom. And all of a sudden, a lot of times, you'd be like, where did everybody go? Just like they find out, Terrell, when 5-0 finally get a hold of the gang member, and they get set to Metro, homies don't come by every week, do they? No, they ain't putting nothing on the book. 2 Timothy 4:16-17. At my first answer, this is Paul, at my first answer, no man stood with me. Can you imagine that? Went to this place, to that place, to this place, to that place, to this place, to that place, to that place. Put my life on the line all the time. Beaten all the time. Matter of fact, stoned to death literally one time. in prison often. There's a whole list of stuff he had to go through. I did that for y'all to get you established in the kingdom. I did it for my king in the kingdom, but I love y'all. I did it for you. And at my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray, God, that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, verse 17, the Lord stood with me. Look at your neighbor and said, the Lord ain't going nowhere. The Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known and that all Gentiles might hear. And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. There is no mention of any Israelite or anyone else for that matter that helped Samson. In fact, after this slaughter, Samson was so thirsty that he thought he would die. And after he had put, listen, he had put his own life. I'm not just talking about spending a few hours doing something you don't want to do. He put his own life at risk to save Israel. But there was none from Israel there to help him. And he only needed a cup of water. See, this is good. This breaks down because anybody can do anything with the crowd. I think I said this last week. You know, I look at, you know, some of these youth events that our youth go to, and they're up there. You know, they got the subs up, they got the lights going, they're all bouncing, and we love Jesus and everything. And that's good and fine as an event. I'm not against that. But the fact of the matter is I know that once they come down to church, we can have the same song. We got subs too. But they ain't bouncing because they just going with the crowd, which means it was never real to begin with. See, that's how you know when it's real, y'all, brothers and sisters. When all these people might leave or forsake you, and you're standing alone, and you know you did the right thing, and you will continue to do the right thing. Don't repay evil for evil. You continually live righteous. But will you still hold on to everything he said, even if you're the only one, and you're alone? Can you do it alone? Sometimes he'll bring you to that place. In fact, after this slaughter, nobody was there. That's not too much to ask for, is it? A cup of water? After putting your life on the line and standing in the way of the enemy, this is how it went down afterwards? Or is this the time you start getting bitter at God? Well, I did what you told me to. And they all left. Ain't nobody around. Matter of fact, I did what you wanted me to do, and I run them all off. I ain't got nobody now. Oh, yeah, you got somebody. You got somebody. Samson never made a request for anyone to bust the bank to bail him out. Just a cup of water would suffice. But they forsook him and fled. Your now what may come with a heavy price. Are you willing to pay? This victory didn't happen by Samson's personal power or ability. This was supernatural. Indeed, all of Samson's feat of strength were not from his own power. And that's the reason the Philistines wanted to know what his secret was. They always wanted to know that, didn't they? You know why? Remember how I broke off Hollywood mindsets when it came to that jawbone? I'm getting ready to break them Hollywood mindsets off you right now. Why would they consistently want to know why he's so strong? I personally believe Samson looked more like Barney Fife than The Rock Dwayne Johnson. Because if somebody come out like Rock having a full pump from the gym and took city gates and was carrying them off, you'd be like, well, yeah,
That's a bad boy right there. But you have Barney Fife come out and do that, and they're like, what in the world? He's 145 pounds soaking wet. That's why they wanted to know. What in the world? Where is that strength coming from? Hallelujah. Didn't the Bible say it itself that not many called that are real smart and real educated and have all this stuff in life? So not many are called like that. Why? Because when the anointing falls and God does mighty things, they can say, yeah, I knew him from high school. That ain't him. That got to be God. That got to be God. That's why he'll call a high school educated hillbilly from the Appalachian Mountains. It got to be God. Hallelujah. Little can do much when the right thing is in the hand of the right person. It's all in whose hands it's in. So don't put into motion somebody else's battle plan of victory and expect it to work for you as it did for them. You have to listen to the Lord for yourself. You can't fight the good fight of faith with someone else's faith. You got to get your own. Look at your neighbor and say, you got to get your own. I hope that, you know, people can look at our lives and our stories and our testimonies, the miracles that the Lord has done with the blind to see and the lame to raise out of wheelchairs, and that can inspire you, but you just got to, you want to be used by the Lord like that, you got to get your own faith. Matter of fact, David found that out, didn't he, in 1 Samuel 17? Didn't fit into Saul's armor. How many armors are you? I see so many people in this phony, fake society. There's no sense of originality anywhere hardly anymore. Everybody wants to, and I know this is going to fly in the face of a lot of y'all. Don't take it the wrong way. I'm not a hater of sports. Matter of fact, I really like college football a lot. But we're in a society where a grown man will pay a lot of money to wear another grown man's name on the back of his shirt.
Don't bring that up, Beth.
Why don't you put your own name back there? Yeah. You know why? Because you don't think you're worthy.
Correct.
Well, ain't nothing special about me. Are you kidding me? 7 billion people and only you have your fingerprint? Do you think it's just church jargon when an anointed man or woman of God says God has a purpose for your life? Do you really believe it? Or is it just, we've heard it so much in church, it just goes in one ear and out the other. It's just church talk. That got your attention, didn't it? David didn't... Okay, I'm glad you won the Super Bowl, Saul, but I'm gonna get my own jersey.
That's right.
As a matter of fact, it don't have to be an actual jersey. I'm going to make sure, because God has called me, that see that big building up there, the CEO's up top, is going to have that. That's where my name going to be. Come on, somebody. But just like we talked about with the car, if you catch the car, Fido, will you know what to do with it? Or are you just going to look around and say, now what? When you know next, you can have your now what. Stand to your feet. We made it, as the music plays. Now what? It may come with many unexpected turns. Now what may come with twists, situations, circumstances, experiences mixed with unseen trials, You're now what may have tribulations, failures, famines, and a monstrosity of awkward moments thrown into a life blender filled with harsh transitions, detached relationships, without anyone understanding or even putting forth a little mercy. Well, that sounds like my life right now. When you know you're next, you can know you're now what. And you don't have to stay in it. This too shall pass. God never wanted his people. He never wants his children to wander around the wilderness for 40 years. He wants you to have the promised land. Get out of the wilderness. He'll feed you in the wilderness, but you can only have so much manna a day. But when you're in the promised land, baby, you can plant as much as you want. But you have to hear the Lord and you have to trust him. It's easy to wake up and get that manna every day, isn't it? It's a different thing to get up and look at that field and be like, there's a lot of work to do. But the Lord promised the increase, the harvest. You're now what? When you know you're next, you know you're now what? But if you prepare your heart and your home to seek the Lord, you too can slay a thousand and show forth heaps upon heaps.